meeting to order, and just want to point out, if there's anyone here that did want to have public comment, please sign in so that we have your names. We have the list here. We have quite an agenda today, so we're going to try to keep everything on time, and we'll, the public comment, we're going to use in 3 minutes. Invoke the 3 minutes to get to give the everybody the opportunity they want. And that said, we if you have something to say and you support somebody else, that's great, or if you want to be very succinct in your comments, we'd appreciate that. So we can get through this agenda in a reasonable time. Can we have a call?
Jeanne LaBrecque.
Here.
John Beitzel.
Here.
Brian Monohon.
Here.
Mike Chapman is excused. Jim McEntire.
Here.
Bill Peach.
Here.
She's still not on the board ever.
She's on leave of absence until you do the resolution.
Sorry. Okay. But she's on the phone.
Yes. She's ready to come back.
All right, we'll do the agenda review. Is there, are there any changes, corrections, or additions to the agenda as it stands? Can I have a motion for approval if there are none?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, the agenda is approved. We have the minutes of the July 21st meeting. Does anyone have any changes or corrections to those minutes or comments?
Move to approve the minutes as written.
Second.
Move to second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay, at this time we'll do public comment, and this is to include items that are on the agenda, and we have one, two, three, four.
No, just one that wishes to speak.
Oh, one to speak. Okay.
Just me.
And that is the asterisk?
Yes. Sorry.
Okay. So that's Stephanie.
Do you want me to go over there? Can I stand here? I'll go over there.
No, you can stand here.
Okay. Sure. Make sure that's in. Have it on me.
Okay. I often never been to your meeting before. So I'm stepping over the kind of public public eye, but I am here as a citizen of Clallam County. And I make this comment, and I'll give you a copy of it. I make this comment to all members of the Clallam County Board of Health to remind the board that Port Angeles is conducting, the city of Port Angeles is conducting a public survey of its citizens regarding fluoridation of the public water system. Of course, you know that. So, is it the board's job to advise the city of Port Angeles on their advisory board votes to their citizens? To me, it is not your job as the Clallam County Board of Health to endorse fluoridation as to endorse fluoridation of Port Angeles drinking water or any other city in the county. Last January at the Port Angeles City Council meeting, I reminded them during the public comment period regarding their school bond issue. The school bond issue was obviously a big thing at the time, that it was not their job as a city council member to endorse a bond issue. At the conclusion of that meeting, they voted not to endorse the school bond issue, but decided that they wanted to support the bond issue as individuals in the community that had the right to do that. So I remind you of the same thing. If you choose to support fluoridation as an individual in the community, I have no problem with that at all. However, you should not endorse fluoridation as a board. This could subject the board, the county, and maybe even you personally to damages if, in the future, some citizen wants to choose to sue over health issues due to fluoridation. This issue is a personal choice issue. The choice to use fluoride or not use fluoride. The choice to put fluoride in my body should be my choice. I am sure that there are many things that the health area that requires patient choice. The Clallam County Board of Health provides, I'm sure, public education on items that require choice. I know the hospital does it on instructing patients on end-of-life choice. That's their choice. The use of fluoride also requires personal choice to use products with fluoride or not use it. So if the Clallam County Board of Health wants to recommend to the hospital foundation that they establish a fund to help indigent families receive fluoride treatment for their young children, and choose to recommend something like that. Choose to encourage the dental association to do the same thing, or more than we are currently doing. Find another way. But as the Board of Health, I recommend do not force the citizens of Port Angeles to continue to medicate with fluoridated water without giving each citizen informed choice. I repeat, it's not the board's job to endorse fluoridation vote on the Port Angeles drinking water.
Thank you. And you are providing a copy? And there are no other public speakers. We have guests, but no other public speakers. Item number five, discussion. First off, an important item is to note the fact that Dr. Stehr-Green has served as our interim health officer in the last, I don't know how many months it's been.
From February 13th.
Oh, that's right, February 13th.
August 31st.
And she's had quite a wonderful experience in that, and as she served and has had many challenges that she has stepped up to and even overcome. So I thought it was appropriate that we as a board recognize her for her contribution, not just to the board, not just to the health department, but to the community at large. So I'd like to note that we have a resolution. Well, one, we want to say thank you, Jeanette. I know you're on the phone. And we also have a resolution that will reinstate her for all her wonderful service back to a full-time member of the board. So would have a motion to do so, or would we have other comments first about Jeanette's serving, or a motion then to reinstate her to the board?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Let's approved. Thank you, Jeanette.
Let me quickly say something. I didn't have thoughts collected well enough.
Sorry.
Earlier, talking about the note of appreciation for Jeanette, and in the impeccable sense of timing category, she and I seem to be partners, because I've gotten on the Board of Natural Resources at just the right time to participate in some very extensive and complicated policy discussions. And Jeanette likewise had an exquisite sense of timing to become the health officer in the midst of a full-blown public health emergency. So I appreciate the aplomb and the expertise with which she brought to that period of emergency, and I can't think of too many other people that would have handled it as well as she did. So kudos, Jeanette, and come back to the board, and then you can be bored and not occupied.
Well, thank you for your kind words. I was very happy to have the skills to bring forward that time, and really appreciate the opportunity to serve a community that my husband and I both love dearly. I've learned so much through my time as health officer, and got to work with some incredible people. Again, I can't say enough good things about staff at Health and Human Services, from the top to the bottom, the front line to the back line. Just an incredible group of people. And at this point, 6.5 months after I started the position, I can't believe, I just can't imagine my life without having done it, and I appreciate the opportunity to have done it. So thank you all so much.
Thank you. On the heels of Jeanette returning to the board and relinquishing her interim designation as health officer, I'd like to welcome Dr. Christopher Frank, who has joined us effective September 1st as the health officer for Clallam County. wisdom for us as you embark on your new journey.
No words of wisdom, but I'm very happy to be here.
Good. A little bit of advice, make your words sweet, because someday you might have to eat them.
Tom Locke is going to join us. He did say he might be a little bit late, and we could kind of move around. I guess I should have noted that earlier. We thought he'd be here right now, but maybe a little bit late. So we'll bring him in when he presents. We have old business and informational items, and so see future agenda items. Is this we're just to jump here for the future, or these?
The only one I can...
Was the burrs was the old item that we were going to bring forward.
Right, for a major discussion.
But I don't think it's on here today.
No,
okay.
None of these three is for today, but if you want some of them for the meeting next month in the forks, just indicate which ones.
Well, then I'll ask the members of the board at the future point what we would want for the meeting in forks. So when we get down there. Health officers report, and I believe, Jeanette, you're going to do this even though we've already reported you to the board. We'll let you step up since you began this effort.
Yes, if Chris doesn't mind, since this is something that had kind of started during my time as a physician, let me talk about this. Is that okay with you, Chris?
Oh, that'd be great.
Okay, so most of you are aware that back in July, the county's syringe services program began distribution of naloxone to clients that were using the syringe services program. Naloxone is a drug that's an antidote to an overdose of an opiate-like drug, and it was thought to be a really good move forward for our community. We have communicable diseases that are reported across the state in that manner. However, there is the potential for individual counties to identify health conditions, health events that are of importance to that locality and make it a notifiable disease or condition. And that is actually in WAC, saying that we are able to do this. So what we would like to propose is to make
good way of developing some program evaluation data to figure out what the appropriate responses to this kind of phenomenon.
Bryon, I can't see whether you're nodding your head or trying to make comment, so I'll ask you specifically if you have anything to say.
We just have a tally up here the last couple of days, so his community is taking it pretty far. So I am fully in support of it. I hate to have any more hero deaths at all. Unfortunately, we probably will, but make sure the life of my health, make sure life is going to be right now. So,
thank you.
I'm trying to figure out how to turn the volume up on this thing. I don't want to cut people off.
And so, Jeanette, I like the next steps, the fact that we want to talk to the potential reporters and get some feedback and then finalize the process and then have a public meeting. I like that process to do that. And then we as a board would vote subsequent to that meeting on November 17th.
Good. And I think, we've already had an initial discussion with OMC Emergency Department. Jessica Berry, who's, I believe, the nurse coordinator, as well as Lorraine Wall and other staff, they're very receptive to this idea. They like that we're approaching it through notifiable diseases, because then that is easier for them to share the information that we're requesting. There are other ways to do it, but it is, much more straightforward for them. So, their initial response was very positive to that. And so I think that bodes well. We will be engaging some kind of more non-traditional reporters, and that's the emergency medical response community. Since when a person has an overdose, 911 is called, that they can't force an individual to go into the emergency department, although it is highly recommended, since sometimes when you administer naloxone, it will revive the person for a short time period, and then they can just go right back into the overdose if the amount of opiate they use is too great. But sometimes, obviously they can't force someone to go into the emergency room for that sort of thing. And so we will be talking with that community and kind of exploring how to get them involved in the reporting. It's very straightforward for the hospitals. It's something that they do all the time. So I think this will be a quite an interesting process, bringing this on board. And I think, but it'll be very positive, because it'll be putting us in connection with those who will do the reporting, will understand any issues that they have. We design the system to address those issues, but then we can move forward together as a unit.
One question, are there operational or database issues that need to be addressed in order to accommodate this new reporting? I mean, I know that you have the state, or who provides the sort of the database information that you input reportable diseases to. There have to be some modifications there for this?
Since this...
Most definitely, and I think that's a good bit of advice or encouragement to look at that as well, and how we would be receiving the information and recording it and analyzing it over time. Since it's not a state level notifiable disease, there's not already a database created. I think it would be relatively straightforward for us to develop our own system, following some of their models and such, but we would be developing some sort of data tracking system ourselves. So we will have to put some attention to that.
Maybe we could have that feedback just so we know what that would entail at the next meeting.
I think that's most reasonable, and we'll add it on the next step.
Okay.
Somewhere in there, about number 3A.
Yeah. I have a comment for Jeanette. We're part of District 10 at the national level, reporting to the Secretary of Health in D.C. And they've expressed a lot of interest in what we're doing about opiates and opioids and all that stuff. And I think they'd like to be notified. They also have the keys to the kingdom when it comes to getting funding.
I'm sorry, I kind of lost that last part. Did you say something about funding?
Funding. I'm hearing noise about databases and record keeping. Yeah, District 10 has people who have connections.
Oh, well, you know, that's very good to know. We actually put out feelers across the United States to see if there were other programs that were already doing notification of this type of a condition. It's quite unusual to our knowledge, and maybe Chris Hurst has gained some more information since I departed, but I don't think there are any other counties in Washington State that are doing this. I believe that Oklahoma State and Texas are doing, they have a notifiable condition that opiate or controlled substance overdose, and so we might learn some lessons from them, but I think it would be great if we could secure some kind of funding, because it's always a bigger job than one appreciates. And so maybe, John, do you have any contacts or thoughts about how we might pursue that with District 10?
Yeah, I'll go through the files. Susan comes out here once every 5 years, so it's not intensive.
Well, if you went through the files, that would be great. I have to say that I connected with Scott Langston, who is the Deputy State Health Officer and also the Communicable Disease Epidemiologist. Scott used to be the Health Officer in Kitsap County, and I connected with him about this, and he was very excited about the possibility that we would do this. Being a model for others, and with kind of keeping that in mind, I think developing a more robust data system might be in order, because it could be something we could be sharing with others. So your thoughts have spurred me on, John, and I think we need to look at that maybe a little more seriously.
So this is Jeanette, are you looking for a resolution or just concurrence on what you have identified as next steps with the addition of looking at databases and or district 10 involvement?
Well, I would certainly feel comfortable just with the concurrence that you feel that this is an appropriate direction, so that we can just do the work we need and then bring it back to the board more formally in November for a vote. But I maybe don't know quite the exact thing, so if you feel comfortable with just concurrence, I'll do that, but a resolution would be fine too. It will work either way for us, I think.
Do we have a motion from any members to either make a concurrence or a resolution to proceed?
It might be useful to have a resolution at some point if we do want to approach funding agencies, okay, but not necessarily immediately.
Okay. Well, then are we sort of in favor of saying this is good to proceed with then?
I'm very much, yeah.
Support concurrence.
Support concurrence? Okay. Bryon? I think?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Jeanette, we give the concurrence.
Okay.
And I'm just wondering if we can,
sure,
we're in the middle of the budgeting process. And looking at next year and the application of this, do you see any expenses that we haven't already provided for in our budget?
Is that Commissioner Peach?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, you know, if there will be staff time, once this is set up, and I don't think it's going to be a huge thing, just because the folks we need to connect with, it's few in number. It's not like most notifiable disease that every healthcare provider and laboratories and others have to be on board. It's very directed at certain reporters, again, the emergency departments and coroner and emergency medical services.
agree with everything that you have said, Jeanette, and I would like to explore that because our syringe service program is very unfunded and has been for a very long time. So that is something that we definitely would need to look at. And as far as the naloxone goes, I would like to report that there have been 5 overdoses since we began using it. 4 people survived because they had naloxone, 1 person did not. So as an evaluation tool of if naloxone works, there's some evidence for us in a 6-week time frame.
So would we then, at this point, add to the next steps also just some consideration, and I'm not familiar with the entire timeline for the budget, but add some consideration for staff time, and also as you look at the syringe program and potential requests for funding, if your two could kind of marry up and go together.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to support what you're doing, but I'd like to put some money into the program if that's necessary.
Okay. I think that's really important to think about up front. Any other questions or comments for Jeanette regarding the proposal? The board has, and I will restate again, given its concurrence for her to proceed with the next steps and bring it back to the board as it develops. Thank you, Jeanette. I see Dr. Locke has entered the room, and I would like to go back to his item on the agenda. Fluoridation of drinking water, and I also like to note at this point we have the former, the previous interim, and the brand new health officer all in the room at the same time, so to speak.
Did you just line up?
Yes, yes.
I'm pleased to join this historic occasion.
Hard to recognize you, Doc. You don't have your mustache.
I know. I know. It's trying the new look here.
Got some information.
Yes. Well, thanks for the invitation. And I was asked to just update the board on what's going on with the issues of community water fluoridation as relates to the Port Angeles Municipal Water System. And just briefly, the history of this is that in 2003, a group of mostly health leaders, physicians, dentists, hospital commissioners, board of health members, a lot of teachers, parents, a coalition formed and brought the idea to the Port Angeles City Council that we have a dental health crisis in the county. We have an access to dental care crisis, and we should be using this tool, community water fluoridation, as a way of dealing with it, as well as a number of other strategies. And long story short, the city council did accept this proposal. It, of course, was not without controversy. Fluoridation is never without controversy. It's community water fluoridation is actually celebrating its 70th year this year. Grand Rapids, Michigan, in 1945, was the first city to be fluoridated. And perhaps the people that are opposed to it are celebrating their 70 years of opposition to it, because it's had a certain element of controversy from its very beginning. But we were able to persuade the city council with the overwhelming scientific evidence that supports both its safety and its effectiveness, and the fact that the organizations that endorse this are a virtual who's who of scientific professional organizations. There's really no one who's not on the list, and there's no credible scientific organizations who are opposed to community water fluoridation. So from a scientific standpoint, I think most experts would consider the science is settled, but the controversy probably never will be, just because it involves water, it involves public water systems. The Port Angeles City Council voted in favor of this in 2003. There were challenges, there were environmental reviews, and it wasn't until 2005 that the equipment was installed, and then officially in May of 2006, Port Angeles began fluoridating their water system under a 10-year contract. They received the equipment was a donation from the Washington Dental Service Foundation, which does this for a number of communities around the state. But the deal is, if you accept the donation, you have to keep using the equipment for 10 years. If you turn it off, you have to pay for the cost of the equipment, which is around $250,000. And so that contract comes to an end in May of 2016. So that I think is the issue that has renewed the public debate on this issue, and it's been heating up. I've gone to a number of meetings. This is the main topic before the city council in most of those meetings. And so and this is what I wanted to update the board about, among other things, that the city has adopted a plan to try to, you know, get public comment in an organized fashion. And so it's scheduled two public meetings in October, both on Thursdays, October 22nd, October 29th. At the first meeting on October 22nd, there will be two groups, you know, a pro and a con group. I've been asked to lead the pro group. Prior to that meeting, the pro and con groups are each to submit 10 questions to the city council that they would like answered. Then the city council will go through those, perhaps add their own questions, and from that selection of questions, they will pick 5 questions for each side, pro and con. And then at the meeting, each side will be given an opportunity for 10 minutes opening statement, 20 minutes to answer your 5 questions, and then 15 minutes sort of closing comments and rebuttal. And that will be the meeting. The city council will sort of sit as observers. There'll be no public testimony. So that will be the October 22nd meeting. It's hopefully a factual presentation of the case by each side. And then 1 week later, it will be public testimony, general public testimony, with a twist. And that twist is that there's two lists. List one is people who want to testify who are users of the Port Angeles Municipal Water System, so that they either live within the city limits, or there are actually some PUD customers outside the city that receive their water from that system. So they will be on list one, and then list two will be anyone else who wants to testify. There'll be 3 hours for testimony. List one gets to testify first, and if they run out of time, that's it. No one on list two gets to testify. But if there is extra time, then people from the non-resident, non-water system user. I think the city council has a very good reason for doing this. It's debates on or discussions of public community water systems tend to draw people from out of area, sometimes, you know, from, you know, elsewhere in the country or the world. You know, there's just this ongoing controversy. People are willing to travel great distances to express usually their opposition to the idea. So, and the council feels, I think, that they've heard enough of that. They really want to hear from the city residents. So that's the structure. And then following that, there will be an opinion poll that will be conducted. At the same time all these other things are going on, the proponents and the opponents of community water fluoridation will prepare draft language to be on an opinion poll, a sort of a 250-word statement, either for or against community water fluoridation. That will go out in a ballot or an opinion poll to that all the users of the system, so all the adult users. It's not voters, it's anyone who is an adult and connected to the system, and it'll be League of Women Voters is involved in this, and there will be, have a prepaid mailer, so they're going to try to get as high a response rate as possible, and then that will be tabulated. In terms of jurisdiction, this is a decision for the Port Angeles City Council. Actually, as a result of lawsuits that were filed related to Port Angeles, this issue went all the way to the state Supreme Court about 3 or 4 years ago, and the Supreme Court ruled in a judgment that applies to the whole state that community water fluoridation is actually not subject to citizen initiative. It's what's known, they classify things, there are legislative decisions and there are administrative decisions. And legislative decisions, that is use of legislative authority, are subject to citizen initiative. Administrative decisions, so what you pay staff or who you hire, who you fire, those are actually not subject to initiative in Washington State. So this is an administrative decision, and it falls to whoever is the administrator of the public water system. So in this case, it's the city council. So they're not really putting this to a vote. They're really not allowed to put it to a vote legally. It's a poll of who supports and who doesn't support this. In terms of actions for the city council, they actually don't have to do anything. If they do nothing, things stay as they are. If they take action before May of 2016, there's a penalty, a financial penalty, if they were to discontinue the system before then. And then after May of 2016, there is no penalty. So that's the basic situation. I was invited to give the hospital staff that does continuing education every other month. So I was offered invited to give a talk on this, which I did yesterday. So if you, I didn't think you would want to hear my 1 hour talk on the history of community water fluoridation and the pathophysiology of dental decay. But that is available. We're circulating it. I designed it to be kind of a standalone presentation that you can read as well as listen to someone talk about. So it's quite an interesting story. There's a lot of information there. But my goal today is just to brief the board on this. I would say as one final comment, from a public health standpoint, community water fluoridation has been established public health policy for a very long time. Centers for Disease Control, which is really the federal agency that deals with drinking water standards, Washington State Department of Health has a very strong position in favor of it, as does the State Board of Health. It's part of their strategic plan for oral health. And the regulations that have to do with drinking water regulate over 50 different chemicals that are used in water treatment and purification. And fluoride is one of those chemicals that is an authorized, regulated water additive to achieve a publicly desirable goal. And I think that the bottom line is why all these organizations support this is not only does it have this long safety record, but it has this extraordinary cost-benefit ratio. It's a very inexpensive way to get a big impact. The cost-benefit statistics for this range from $20 to $80 benefit for every dollar you spend. The most commonly cited one is, and it's a conservative estimate, is $34 every dollar you invest, you save $34. And that's just in direct dental costs. You know, when you factor in pain and suffering and, you know, the psychological disability that comes with tooth loss and all of those aspects, I think you could argue the benefit is much higher. So I'm happy, if the board has any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them.
Any questions on the board? So we really have a rather robust process in place at this time, and the city is working through that, and the council will have the ultimate say as to how they proceed.
Right.
Jeanette or Bryon on the phone?
Yes.
Do you have any questions?
Jeanette?
No, I don't have any questions.
Any other comments or thoughts?
When are the poll results likely to be public?
It will go out, this is just from memory, I believe it will go out in the very early part of November, and then it's, what I remember is late November. It's really not time, it's independent of the election cycle, because it's not really an issue related to that. But it, certainly by year's end, the poll should be tabulated and available.
So is your presentation available on Amazon.com or Prime or your Nook or where will we find your presentation?
Well, now you're giving me some ideas.
Oh.
I'd be happy to, I'll send a copy here to the health department. I've actually got a printing copy. It's a PowerPoint, probably.
Sure.
Best of luck on the computer. It's got a lot of pictures of teeth in it, as you might imagine. So I know I sent a copy to the hospital and got a request from the medical staff that the people were not able to attend the meeting, but might go through it. So I'll put it on. I mean, you're welcome to put it on the website or use public domain as far as I'm concerned. So
great. Any other questions for Dr. Locke? Really appreciate your time and helping us understand the process thoroughly. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, John, I'm going to excuse myself.
Sure.
Get back to my clinic job.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Good talk.
Environmental Health Director.
Excuse myself.
Oh.
Take a minute. I'll be right back. Not later.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So, in the first line of the agenda, we're going to talk about the Port Angeles Health Consultation. And just a little bit of background about this is, I think, as part of the investigation EPA was performing on the Rainier contamination around the Rainier site, they also started to take a look at what was going on as far as sedimentation in the harbor. And so their initial investigation, I think they had one crab sample, and that particular crab sample did show some high readings of organics. And at that point, Dr. Locke was in consultation, I think, with the Lower Elwha tribe, who was concerned about contamination of crab, and that people were, aside from tribal folks, there were also recreational crabbers in the harbor. And so, growing out of that, Dr. Locke issued an interim health advisory on the eating of crab. And that, I think, went in, how did I miss it? 2007. And it's kind of just been there since then. And I think when out as a press release a long time ago, and it's just kind of been languishing, I guess. So it was always our hope that there would be some additional information, additional sampling, to give us a little more clarity about what was going on as far as crab and other shellfish resources in the bay. Because periodically we would get calls from the public, like, well, you know, what's going on, and does it eat anything there? So we did ask the Department of Health for some additional help. They issued this health consultation just last month, I think. And so to present the information, I thought it would be best to come from them. So we invited the folks from the Department of Health who actually worked on the consultation, and we are glad that they are here today to give us a presentation on the findings. And I would ask them to at least identify yourselves so that people know who you are.
Did you want to move to the table?
You can move to wherever you're comfortable.
Taken out
These river samples are taken by ecology, and out here we have a group of mussel samples, and these are from the NOAA Mussel Watch program. They have a few hundred sites around the coast, around the U.S., and so it just happened that one of their sites is located on Edith's Hook, so we use that data as well. So in order to calculate how much a person could be exposed to these chemicals consumed, we had to, we looked at a couple of scenarios. The first is for the state resident, and the second scenario was for a tribal consumer. Well, so they tend to consume a lot more seafood than the typical state resident. So these values listed here were agreed upon by our stakeholders that we worked with at the beginning, including Clallam County and the two tribes that we worked with, the Lower Elwha Clallam Tribe and the Jamestown Scallam. And also ecology was part of this process too. So this is just a brief synopsis of how we did our cancer and non-cancer evaluation. We basically used established health values from ATSDR or EPA to do the initial screening of the contaminant levels. We would estimate a dose that a person would be exposed to for both the state resident scenario and the tribal scenario, which is more hypothetical because we really don't think anyone is consuming all their seafood from Port Angeles Harbor at a tribal rate. And so we would compare that to levels that were documented in studies to have caused adverse health effects for each of the chemicals that were analyzed. And for cancer risk, we only did this for the chemicals that would be carcinogenic or causing cancer. And for any chemical that causes a lifetime excess cancer risk of over 1 in 10,000, we would consider that significant to public health. So this excess cancer risk really means that for any chemical that would cause an additional one case of cancer among 10,000 similarly exposed individuals is really how we define the lifetime excess cancer risk. And also at the end of this, we wanted to calculate how many servings of crab could a person have without experiencing potentially harmful side effects from these chemicals. So we looked for the lowest, we found the lowest number of meals a person could have. And one serving is can be approximated to about the size of your and thickness of your hand. And so our conclusions were that if a person were to consume crab, it would present some significant cancer risks. And at a tribal consumption rate, it would present even higher cancer risks. But in addition to that, we have found maybe some non-cancer effects that would occur, such as gastrointestinal irritation from excess copper and decreased immune function, or neurobehavioral problems from PCBs at their consumption rate. But this is all very hypothetical because, as stated in the report, we really don't believe that anyone is consuming seafood at this very high consumption rate from Port Angeles Harbor. And lastly, we found that eating mussels or coon-striped shrimp are not expected to be harmful, and this is solely based on the chemical data. And we did not look at any biological hazards or potential concerns from sewer overflows in the area. So we also recommended at the end that people should not be eating crab butter at all with the levels, with the high levels of chemicals found in that tissue. But for crab meat, we're recommending limiting intake to 4 meals per month. also working with our shellfish safety program at the Department of Health. They have identified various sanitary concerns with the sewer overflows in the area, so we're recommending that the entire area is permanently closed to shellfish harvesting. So, and shellfish, as defined by Department of Health, includes bivalves such as mussels and scallops, clams, and oysters. So at the end of this, due to the limited data that we have, and also changing environment in the future, we recommend more sampling in the future, and we want to work with stakeholders to ensure that our recommendations are being monitored and still up to date. So if there is future sampling, we want to make sure that the sampling would be available for us to use in a health consultation. And we want to work with ecology perhaps after they complete any cleanup processes in the area. So currently we're at this stage with our public health action plan. We've developed some public health health outreach material, and I think it is at the end of your packet where we have a single page, which basically is our public health message, yes, to the public. The front slide is primarily for a general audience, and the back side is more of a summary of the health consultation report. We also are assisting the county with any of their other educational outreach needs. And we also plan to meet with stakeholders in the future about sampling in the harbor so that we could perhaps update our health consultation. And finally, we'd like to thank the Clallam County Environmental Health for their cooperation with us on this, and also the two tribes, the State Department of Ecology, and some programs at the Department of Health that we work with, including shellfish safety and fish advisories. And I have my contact listed here in case you have any more technical questions about the report, and Lindsay's contact is also listed here if you have questions related to public health outreach with this site. So thank you for having us.
Do we have any questions for Amy?
How do the consumption rates, let me back up a little bit. There is a rulemaking effort by the Department of Ecology.
Correct.
Associated with clean water. Assumes certain consumption rates and so forth that is different than the assumptions that have been long established in the past. How do those rates compare with the, and I honestly don't know if the ecology has actually published a draft rule at this point or if they're just talking about it.
They're talking about it. I think currently it's 6.5 grams per day, which is much lower than the 175 we're using here.
I was wondering how those consumption rate assumptions compare to statewide effort.
It's much higher. And this is really a rate that is, I think they're calling it a rate under consideration for the water quality standards. But we've agreed to that this was much more reflective, perhaps, than 6.5 grams per day, which is very low. So this is
really kind of the worst case. You could characterize it fairly as a case that's not the worst case scenario, but a much worser case scenario than what's contemplated for the statewide clean water rule, I suppose.
Yes. The tribal rates would be reflective of a very high consumer.
Yeah.
They have a very high consumption rate, and I feel. We felt like this really really was more hypothetical in nature for this evaluation.
Okay, yeah. I was curious about that.
This is the study or consultation was done within the harbor.
Correct.
Okay, so if you just go on the other side of the hook, you're not in the harbor.
Correct.
And so delineation of and recommendations pertaining just to the harbor, really, there haven't been studied outside of that, I guess, and or how did the public?
This consultation is really limited to the harbor, and Len has a comment in the back.
Yeah, the Fish Advisory Group has a document that's coming out within the next couple of months that deal with the whole Puget Sound as a whole. Each of the different region within the Puget Sound have different fishing areas, and they're dealing with that separately. So in the next 2 or 3 months, that document should be out.
Which would give us a more holistic picture.
Yes. So I think this region is, I think
Marine
it's region
area six.
Six, yeah. So they're gonna have a fish advisory for region six, excluding the harbor area, which this would stay, remain in place.
Bryon or Jeanette, do you have any questions?
No.
No, I actually had the opportunity to read through the report that was developed for this, and it was amazing. It just had so much good content to it, and you know, the final bottom line messages of what this means, and I think we're most appreciative of DOH's time on this particular study.
Thank you.
How will the educational materials be used? I mean, is that just kind of up to the county here? Or?
We are working with the city, and we just had a meeting with them this morning discussing outreach for this site. So I believe we're finalizing this sheet by Friday, and at least having it posted on our website, site assessments website, along with the health consultation. So, yes, Lindsay will be handling more of the communication regarding outreach at this site, but we're working with the city on this.
So it's still in the works.
Yes.
Any other questions?
How many samples were taken?
There were, it's listed in the health the actual health consultation report. There were a minimum of three. So shrimp, I believe, had three. And let me see if I can go up to. Yeah. And these are composited samples, so each sample would be made of, I think there were 11 pieces of shrimp mixed together, and then that was called one sample. And I believe that table outlining the number of samples was in the report in the discussion section. I think for crab, there were, depending on whether they were individual samples or composited samples, I believe there were like 11. But I should check with that table in the report. Yeah. It should be right after the map. Okay,
yeah.
Right there.
So does it share the degree of confidence that sampling results in?
It shows the composited, whether they're composited or individual. We had a mixture of different samples, so really we had to separate them, the analysis by tissue type. So crab butter was evaluated separately from crab tissue meat. Which is why we really recommended more sampling. It's very limited. And this is the most recent data, even though some of it is from 2002, which is really a stretch for us to really make health conclusions from. But we really prefer samples that have been taken within the past 10 years.
Any other questions?
Matt?
been sampled at all inside the harbor, inside the perimeter of the Pettishook, let's say around the mill? I mean, historically, we harvested crab and shrimp clear inside the harbor near the shore.
These data were made available to us by the Department of Ecology, so we really didn't have access to funding for us to do any sampling of our own. So this was taken from largely the Rainier Mill cleanup site.
Okay.
As part of their remedial investigation, I believe. And this one, again, was a part of a national mussel watch program, so it just happened that that there was a site here. And we basically tried to pull in as much data as we could from what we had available to us, but we don't really have any funding to do our own sampling.
Can I ask one more question? You said on one of your slides that mussels and a hooch striped shrimp were okay to eat, but on the second slide you said that you didn't shellfish, you wouldn't advise consumption of shellfish within the harbor?
Oh, yes. Shellfish is defined by this is a, each agency, has their own definition of what is considered shellfish, and for us, for Department of Health, shellfish means bivalves. So it would include mussels, but it would not include shrimp.
Right.
It also does not include crab. So that's why we had a separate recommendation just for crabs. And yes, there's a lot of definitions were a bit confusing, but we worked them out. Trying to be consistent with our agency's definitions of species.
You said you were looking at and recommended more sampling, mm-hmm. and then again you said there was no funding to do so.
We're going to talk to ecology after their cleanup, if they're doing additional monitoring of the cleanup site. So we want to work in some, or ask about if they can use some of their funding to look at species that are relevant to the community, such as crab.
Anything else? Thank you.
Thanks again for that presentation. This is more of a, I guess, a news update about what's going on in Dungeness as far as the commercial shellfish beds. And so recently we learned that the State Department of Health was going to upgrade certain parts of the shellfish areas from one section of 680 acres was designated as commercially approved, conditionally approved, which basically meant that during certain times of the year it would be closed. And those times were generally times of wet weather events, which might have heightened the amount of activity in the water. But over a period of 30 samples, which takes a fair amount of time, the last three samples show that those areas are now in the basically group category, and so that they are going to officially upgrade the area. They also took a look at 40 acres, and you can take a look at, there's two maps, one on page 2 and one on page 5. And you can see on page 5 is the basically the best one, where it says right here, the areas, this was once conditionally approved, this would have been this tannish area and is now all green. Oh, I'm sorry, I had to do it. And there is two areas down here which were in the red zone, but now those have been changed to condition approved, so those are also upgraded. So, you know, this is really, I think, fantastic news because we've been working for a very long time on trying to get the, improve the water quality of the bay. You know, there's just a number of sources that have been identified as contributors, but stormwater from irrigation outfalls, and of course, on-site septic systems were two sources that were identified. And over a period of probably a decade or so, conservation district, and of course, we've been fairly vigilant since about 2007 of working with people to get systems fixed. And so we're going to take at least partial responsibility for the effort.
You should take a big bow. This is huge.
So, you know, there are places when networks are being downgraded, and when I saw this, it's like, oh, this is great news for Clallam County. So I just wanted to pass that on to the Board of Health, and that we are still looking at part of our PIC program. You know, the, as part of the findings, there were, you know, the Department of Health identified, Meadowbrook Creek and Meadowbrook Slough as possible problem areas that have continued over time. And they are identified in our initial project. Right now, we are concentrating on golden sands because we're finding some evidence right there that needs immediate attention. But we will be shifting over to Meadowbrook Creek and Meadowbrook Slough to see what we can do as far as cleanup. So that's on our agenda for the next also.
That's in the great.
Yeah, that's in the great.
Any questions for Andy?
Well, this is the fecal coliform equivalent of community policing. You gotta go where the crime is, so to say.
Yeah. I'm not sure if I could call it quite that way. But, you know. Yeah, we're like I said, we've been vigilant and I think it's
well done.
It's good to see some success.
Yeah.
Good. Congratulations.
Question? Andy, are we gonna get this out to the media?
I think one thing is we did want to get to the Board of Health, make sure that we knew, and then I'm gonna probably call the Department of Health tomorrow and ask them, are they gonna do a press release or are we gonna
if they don't, we should.
Yeah, oh, definitely.
I don't think they need to wait for a question, but it's
okay.
That's why we like it.
That's great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Andy. Public Health Program Manager.
Yes. Okay. Good afternoon. To do a follow-up on a couple of items for you this afternoon and school events. And for the sake of conversation, if you wouldn't mind, I'd like to put that to the October meeting because we have another event coming up that is going to be happening in Forks on October 1st, and that will give me a little bit better feel for how things went from all the areas that we did. And this is related to in our school settings and bringing up immunization rates and also bringing up compliance rates with the schools and requirements. There have been some changes in the immunization laws, so the schools are doing a little backpedaling and we've been trying to help them catch up a little bit. So if I could do that, that would give us a little bit more information on that that I could share with you at that time.
We'll move that to the future for the Forks meeting.
The next one is our project to evaluate the occurrence of syringes in public settings. And the syringe service program is one of the programs that does dominate a lot of my time. And it's a project that we work very hard on to make sure that we're following best practices and doing everything to the best of our ability. And there is a local citizen action group called PA CAN, if you have not heard of it, Port Angeles Community Citizen Action Network.
And they are wanting to do citizen initiatives to address substance abuse in our community. And so they have approached me on several occasions, and I've been working with them for several months now to look at syringes that are getting thrown on the ground on the in the public. And so we put together a couple of things to try and get a real feel for this. So one of the challenges that I've had is listening to urban myth that says syringes are everywhere in public, they're all over the parks, to actually getting some hardcore data. And I really need some hardcore data so I can define what the problem is. So when Jeanette was at our lead, worked with Jeanette, and we put up some really big maps of the county, and I have been advertising through this citizen group to begin disclosing to me where they are finding these syringes and giving them the option to bring them into the public health department, and I will dispose of them for them. And so since July 25th, we have been getting some actual hardcore numbers, which gives me a little bit more information to go off, and it tells us locations in the community that may have higher rates of syringes being thrown in public. Since that time, we've also met twice with the city of Port Angeles to determine what their philosophy on syringes in public are, what information they give to the citizens when they get phone calls to the police department or to the city offices. And they really didn't have a message. So we have this wonderful brochure that discusses what you can do with medical syringes that you need to dispose of, or if you find them in public, what you can do. And we have put together a plan to do a major PR campaign as a partnership with the city of Port Angeles in a couple of weeks. We're putting together some final touches on it so that we're all singing the same song, and we're all talking about the same messages, and we're all giving the same information. And so that is one of the most recent things that has happened. We all want solutions to this problem. We all want to deal with the syringe problems of being thrown down in public. From the syringe service program, this will require a large educational campaign with our clients that come through our door as well, and explaining to them the hazards of throwing syringes in public, and so giving it a rounded feel, but it will give us a little bit more information. And I really need some data. I need to know where they're being found, what locations, how many. Is this the first time? Is this the fifth time? Is this a common location? And so now I'm beginning to put some of that information together. And as we build this out with the city and making this a larger PR campaign, all of us will be given the same information, which will increase the amount of data that I'm able to pull together over the next 5 or 6 months to really see what our information is and can we really do something with this to begin making some changes in this. I do think we can. I think the area that's lacking is I don't have solid information other than someone just saying, well, there's parks all over that have syringes. Well, I need to know where, and I need to have real hardcore information. So I will give you more details on that as we get a little bit farther in, but I did want to give you a heads up. We are working with the city. If you are getting phone calls, I'm the person that's meeting with them. If you have questions or they have questions, I'd be happy to talk to them a little bit more, but I will be giving you more information on this as we move along into the future. I anticipate this being an ongoing project for a little while to really affect some change within that program.
You started on July 26th with the PA camp sort of gathering data at that point.
Yes, that was the first day I started taking actual reports.
And just out of curiosity, since that time, I know it's up the top.
How many members? It's just below 200 right now.
And that's
150 of them were in one location. So we actually came across a little dump site that was accidental. Most of the locations are places that are just one or two syringes at a time. But that's one or two syringes that need to be dealt with.
So it was an accidental dump site, you said? So it wasn't a gathering? Okay.
Right. No. And those are the kinds of things we need to know so that we can begin dealing with some of those questions that are coming up.
How do you know it was accidental?
That is when we joined up with PA CAN, and we are doing regular park cleanups with them and the city of Port Angeles. So we did a big park cleanup that day. We did five local parks, picked up how many syringes that we found, plus picked up a lot of other garbage such as beer bottles, gum wrappers, food wrappers, you know, all kinds of things. It wasn't just geared towards syringes, but I wanted to make sure that we were making a presence to educate people on how to safely pick up a syringe so that we didn't have any issues to deal with. And so from that time on, we've continued. Our next park cleanup event is 9/19, which is this Saturday at 9 a.m. And this is a partnership that we have built with the Salmon Coalition and the Friends of Peabody Creek. And this cleanup is specifically going to look at Peabody Creek, right behind 3rd Street going down the hill where it's got that beautiful little alcove underneath there. And it's also going to do, it's broadened out to dealing with some invasive weeds that are underneath there and helping get that stream to be a little bit more free-flowing and make it more of an inviting public environment. So that will be our next park cleanup this Saturday. So if you're interested in participating, 9 a.m. we're meeting at Olympic Power Sports on 3rd Street and Peabody, and that's where we'll be for about 3 hours that morning. Okay. Any other questions on the syringe disposal piece?
I just wanted to say that I appreciate your approach, Chris.
Thank you.
Chris, there'll be an article in the paper. I just worked with member and staff. A landowner contacted a staff member about litter and syringes. And the paper was kind enough, the person wrote a letter to the newspaper, and the paper was kind enough to allow the county employee to respond. It did not include what you have just shared.
Was that in today's paper? I did read the editorial. Was it from the Dungeness Trail? That was in today's paper.
Okay. And so there's an opportunity, if possible, for us to send a message. We didn't have this information when the document that we released was sent yesterday.
And that's a big reason why we kind of like to coordinate interested parties and be using the same information, because I think the information is very disjointed and we all need to be giving the same message. So that's one of the reasons the city has been so instrumental in helping us do a lot of this work. The other update I wanted to give you was on our Secures messaging system. Secures is a 24-hour emergency notification system for public health emergencies. It is offered to us through the Washington State Department of Health, and using this system is in our preparedness consolidated contract. So we took the opportunity to transfer over this as our 24-hour emergency notification system a few months ago, when we had the opportunity to have a very charming young intern, a nursing intern named Taylor, with us, and she helped transfer over all that information. So this is the system that we will now use in public health emergencies to notify all local providers in the community. And as people would like to be added to this, we have a place where they can be put on for an email notification as well. So this is the first time that we are beginning to use email, and I anticipate it will take some time for the email portion of it to be built up. But this is the main notification system that we will be using now. We had a great opportunity to get this done, so we jumped on it. It's a great system.
Questions?
So, Jeanne?
Yes.
This is Jeanette. I just wanted to kind of thank Chris for bringing this project further ahead this summer. I think that the messaging system is really important, and having a baffle system that can allow you to identify subgroups that you want to send messages to is critical, and having up-to-date contact information also incredibly important. And so I guess a message
via email, right?
Yes, you have the newsletter? Yes, you do.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Health director.
Okay, accountable communities of health. We'll have a telephone call for folk on the planning subcommittee probably in the next 2 weeks, and there'll be a large stakeholders meeting in November, I think it's first week of November, at Port Gamble, where we met before. The biggest news, last month, you remember, Peter Brown was here to address us about that. And before I came upstairs today, I received an email from him indicating that he will be leaving the middle of October to take another position in British Columbia. So I cannot tell you who will take on that facilitator role at that point.
And he's part-time, as he
yes.
is.
Yeah. Yes.
It's interesting.
So that's kind of late-breaking news with the kind of communities of health. For Behavioral Health Organization, which is what the regional support networks will evolve into, we do have a meeting of some of the interested folk this Thursday in Port Townsend. That would be the directors of health and human services in all three counties, two commissioners, and possibly one or two legal representatives. Then on Friday of this week, Commissioner Peach, as the RSN representative for Clallam County, will have an executive committee meeting. So that continues to move along. We were hoping to get more in step with the accountable communities of health, but I'm not quite sure with the leading of the facilitator how that will be brought together again.
Because they're really just in the phase of sort of
correct.
Getting their organizational structure correct. Established.
Yeah.
If I can add, there's
yes, sir.
An issue that that I think is very important for us to consider, and that is as the three counties get together in this organization, currently what's being proposed is liability that can transfer to Clallam County from the other two counties, okay? And it's joint and severable liability that right now is only covered with a requirement for Kitsap to maintain $2 million in insurance coverage. The issue for Clallam County is we have assets, we have reserves that the other two counties do not. And so I'm being very careful. And it was discussed at the commissioners' meeting on Monday. And thanks to Iva's participation in this, I want to look very, very carefully to make sure that we support operationally what's occurring without jeopardizing the resources of the county. And my, you know, the message was initially presented just by Clallam County, and now Clallam County of Jefferson County. Those are the two county commissioners that are going to be meeting Thursday, are saying, oh, we think there's a liability issue. Why do some counties form limited liability corporations? And we haven't even had that conversation. So it was actually Commissioner McEntire that suggested that an approach we might consider is to have the contract have a finite life. Give us 6 to 12 months. Within which the legal staff can review the issue. If we perceive a better approach, we can the contract would expire, and we can use the new approach. We want to keep the wheels in motion, and now especially some of our supporters are available. That there is a fundamental liability issue that we want to address.
And that liability is with respect to the RSN evolving into a BHO or with respect to the ACH,
the RSN evolving into the BOH. The liabilities will be very different in the accountable communities of health.
But we do have two things going on at the
yes.
same time, two structures
yes.
evolving that we need to be aware of.
Right.
When that's kind of the issue, it's, you know, what really is
against the future, and you ask, and you get a very negative response. And that tells me to be cautious on the issue of liability.
Anything else from the health department?
No, just a big thank you to Chris for working so hard on this, collecting the syringes and finding out where they're coming from. Because a lot of syringes look the same, but they may not be the ones we handed out.
Board discussion. We do have a meeting coming up in Forks on the 20th of October. We will get information subsequently.
Bryon has
a location.
Has gotten us a location at the Rainforest Center.
Beautiful building.
Will Cheryl be coordinating board members getting right out there, perhaps in the county van?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
So more to come on that meeting.
More to come. You will be getting some emails so we know who wants to ride out and who doesn't.
And then for future meeting agenda items, we did, Chris did request that we take the middle school update to that, and that would be in, at the Forks meeting. We have the 10-year plan to end homelessness, the MERS, and the BHO we can discuss briefly today, but further subsequent updates on that. Any other agenda items?
There will be one, since we will be in Forks, and our children with special health care needs caseworker is located in Forks, even though she serves the whole county. I did want her to give a program update. I think it would be very interesting for the health to hear what's done in that program.
Okay. We have no further public comment, I don't think. Didn't see anyone responding or anything. Anything else for discussion from the board? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second.
Thank you.